This drink is so good.
Hi, everyone. I'm Heaven.
I'm Tracy.
And welcome to another round with Heaven and Tracy.
Woo! Yay!
I feel like at one point we're going to need to change up the intro.
I know. Well, I tried. Wow. That didn't really...
It's so sarcastic. Anyways, on to our show.
On to the show.
What do we got for the people today, Tracy?
Well, for the people, we have lots of bourbon. That's more for us.
Yes.
For us, we have lots of bourbon. Also, we have another edition of Tracy's Animal Corner. Woo! I'm really excited. We also have the first installment of our brand new in-house game show, 6 Degrees of Housing Separation with Gene Demby of NPR's Code Switch.
That is not how you say it, Tracy.
What?
6 Degrees of Housing Segregation.
Ba-dum-bom.
Ba-dum-bom. Very fun show, guys.
Yeah, it's going to be great. And also, we will be talking to investigative reporter Nikole Hannah-Jones about stuff.
She writes about so many things, honestly. I don't even know what to pick out.
She writes about music. She writes a lot about segregation and...
education.
Public school system.
Affirmative action. Like, literally everything.
Seriously, everything. So we're going to talk to her about everything. So let's get going. Well, kids, it is that time again.
What time is it? Sorry, I missed my cue.
It's time for Tracy's Animal Corner. Animal Corner. Talking about birds most of the time. One day we'll talk about things that don't fly, maybe.
Beautiful, Tracy. Beautiful.
Thank you. So I'm super excited about this edition of Tracy's Animal Corner because this is an animal that has flown into my heart, you might say.
Oh, my God. Jesus. This is how we're starting today.
Pigeons, man. I feel like pigeons just get such a bad rap. People love to say that pigeons are just like rats with wings. So insulting to an animal that is doper than many people know. I feel like
You were going to say doper than many people.
I know a lot of people who I would rank below pigeons in my life.
You ain't lying.
Why don't you like pigeons, Evan?
They like shit.
Okay, everybody shits. Pigeons can't help that.
Everyone poops. Yeah, but it's like at inopportune times and they're flying over you and then they shit on you. That's not fun. I don't shit over people. That would be horrible.
Okay, that being said, I feel like that's not enough to hate pigeons. First of all.
I'm good.
They are super romantic. They mate for life, which means they are much more faithful than your ex. Point for pigeons. Point for pigeons. They are really smart. Mm. Pigeons are often placed on lists of the most intelligent animals.
What?
Yes, I swear to God. Carrier pigeons. So, like, they can be trained. You know what, like, the deal with carrier pigeons, right?
I actually don't.
Oh, my God. I'm so happy to explain this. So, it's actually not that much to explain, but, like... During World War I, military soldiers would train pigeons to carry secret messages for them across enemy lines. There's one pigeon in particular named, I don't know how to speak French, named Cher Ami.
My dear friend.
This pigeon saved nearly 200 soldiers, French soldiers.
I'm sorry. What?
Exactly. Listen, this pigeon, and I'm reading this from the Smithsonian's website. So the Smithsonian says that he was a registered black. He was a registered black check cock. Is it cock? Carrier pigeon, one of 600 birds owned and flown by the U.S. Army Signal Corps in France during World War I. So he delivered 12 important messages. For the Americans, right? Across enemy lines, got shot in the breast, somehow still made it to his destination. That's what the Smithsonian says. If you're prepared to call the Smithsonian a liar, I mean, guess you can do that.
What a narrative, though.
I mean, it's, right? This is exciting. So it says, just a few hours after the message was received, the message that Cherami was carrying, 194 survivors of the battalion were safe behind American lines. How many people have you saved in War Heaven? I don't know. I've never saved any.
I just sit and shit. I don't do anything.
So there's that. That's really, really freaking impressive.
I honestly didn't know, like, carrier pigeons were real.
Ta-da. Amazing. So they're highly trainable. They can also recognize individual people, like, by facial features.
Is that why they bother me specifically?
It could be. Yeah. They feel your bad vibes and then it's like, no. Overall, they're just trying to live, you know? People are always talking about how dirty they are. Maybe the cities that they're living in shouldn't be so dirty. Maybe.
No one's going to argue that.
Okay, point for pigeons. Point for pigeons. Pigeons are dirty because we are dirty. We need to sweep around our own front doors, as my grandmother would say, before we talk about somebody else's dirt. Also, this is what really endeared me to pigeons in the first place. Mm. I say this all the time, and I say it because I mean it. Pigeons are the black man of the bird world.
For everyone who's like, what the fuck, Tracy? What does that mean?
Well, pigeons and doves, same thing. They're the same animals.
Doves, like same species, just different color?
Doves, exactly. Doves are pigeons. Pigeons are doves. But which one gets all the love and is like in the Bible for being like peacemakers? And oh, they're so beautiful. Let's set them free at weddings and at funerals. Oh my gosh.
That always fails.
Always. But they're white ones. If doves were black, they would be pigeons and everybody would hate them.
Why don't I see more doves then?
Hey, man, it's a good question. I don't know. Where are they at? Well, they've all been harvested to let go at people's weddings.
Wow.
I don't know.
You made that up.
I just made it up.
You could have said anything right there. I would have believed
you.
I know.
So, like, one is white, one is black, one has the better life and not the privilege, the other one doesn't. I relate. That's all I'm trying to say. I relate to pigeons.
Pigeon lives matter.
Pigeon lives matter.
Oh my God, Tracy.
Don't hate pigeons. I mean, seagulls. Let's put all of our hate that we have for pigeons into seagulls.
That's fair.
Horrible.
They're horrible.
They're terrible. Like, pigeons typically will leave you alone. You know, they may not get out of your way if you live in a city. But I mean, like, if you are anywhere near a seagull and the seagull has beef with you, wants some of what you eat, and that's it, it's over. It's yeah, directly in your face.
That's so true.
The biggest threat in the bird world, seagulls, not pigeons. Anyway, guys, that's why you should love pigeons more. If you hate pigeons but you love doves, you might be racist. So,
oh my God,
figure it out.
And on that note, this has been Tracy's Animal Corner.
Pigeon.
Incredible.
Thank you.
Pigeon. We need a trap remix.
We need a trap remix.
We are so excited to have Gene Demby. If you recall, he's the fourth guest we've ever had on the show. He's the lead blogger at NPR's Code Switch, and we're very excited to be connecting with him from Washington, D.C.
Yay!
We are very excited to have Gene here for a little segment I'm going to call 6 Degrees of Housing Segregation. We're gonna have the music later when we do the actual intro.
Y'all been talking about this forever, and that was the best y'all could do music wise.
No, it's not. Okay, hold on, guys.
Here's what you're not gonna do.
Hold on, everyone.
Okay.
From Bob and Jerome Studios in New York City, it's 6 Degrees of Housing Segregation.
Yay!
Gene Demby, come on down. You're the next contestant.
Oh my, I'm waving to the crowd. I'm slapping high fives to everybody.
Welcome to the show. I'm Bob Barker. We're going to be giving Gene 3 random topics that we pulled from the news, and he has 90 seconds to bring us from that topic to housing segregation in six degrees or less.
I'm so nervous.
You ready, Gene?
I'm so nervous. I'm very nervous, but I'm going to do it.
So, Gene, why do you always tweet about this? I feel like every tweet I see, Gene is like, you know what this comes back to. So what is it? What do you think it is about housing segregation that makes it 6 degrees from every ill society is facing?
You make it sound like I'm like the dude from The Nation who just got out of prison. Like, you know what this is about for real, though, right?
I mean,
you know, it just, when we write about race, like all the stuff, when you talk about racial disparities, you talk about education, when you talk about like household wealth, we talk about like health outcomes, all that stuff is about where you live, right? And all that stuff is about the way our policies have been formed. I'm not going to be super boring about this, but race and space, basically. Mm. If you grow up in the hood, the hood exists for a reason. If you grew up in the suburbs exist for a reason. And those reasons are explicitly racial. And whenever we talk about this stuff, it's always like, you can always do just a little bit of digging, a little bit of poking, like, oh, this is about race policies, right? We're talking about school, we're talking about obesity rates, all that stuff is about where you live and all that stuff about, and where you live is about race.
Word. So we are going to put Gene to the test, guys. The topic is, the recipe for pumpkin spice lattes has changed recently to include actual pumpkin. The quote from Starbucks blog is, it will be made with real pumpkin and without caramel coloring. Gene, how does this relate to housing segregation? Eleanor, 90 seconds on the clock.
And go.
Okay, let us stipulate that pumpkin spice is about race, right? Because we always talk about pumpkin spice and basicness, and we talk about pumpkin spice and Ugg boots. We're talking about white people. We're talking about white women. That's what we're talking about implicitly, right? Mm-hmm. Anyway, pumpkin spice is a belongs to the taste palette of a certain kind of white people, at least in people's ideas, right? Pumpkin spice is also one of the like staples of the fall Starbucks menu, mm-hmm. right? So Starbucks is always on the front lines of gentrification. It's always the first thing you know. When your hood is gentrifying, you're like, oh, Starbucks is here. It's over. Pack it up. This bodega gonna close down. The Starbucks is here, right?
Word, true.
Okay, and so then you have the foodies who come in with gentrification, right? They're like, no, we only want natural stuff. We want like artisanal pumpkin spice, which is ridiculous because pumpkin spice is the name of a Bath and Body Works aroma, probably. That's what does pumpkin spice even mean? Okay, so you get from the introduction of Starbucks you have this white people flavor. I'm simplifying here. You have this white people flavor coming in with Starbucks on the bleeding edge of gentrification. And once they get into the neighborhood, they're like, no, we want the real shit. We want the real shit.
10 seconds left.
And the real shit is natural, non-artificial pumpkin spice flavor. Boom.
That's time.
Yeah, I was very impressed.
Wow.
So we went from pumpkin spice latte to like food deserts and housing segregation from like the way the hood works when gentrification happens.
All right.
Was like 2 degrees.
Was that reasonable?
Yeah.
Was that applausible?
I will give you that round, Gene.
Point for Gene.
Thank you. What do I get if I win?
Our love and attention.
Yay.
I already get that. I mean,
you get double the amount.
So the next round is the fight over Uber. So what I mean by that is Uber has been is a car service app that's been around for a while, but it's been growing extensively and aggressively the past few years. So part of the controversy is how they treat and categorize their employees. Are they contractors? Are they employees? Their relationships and competition with the existing like taxi economy, their relationship to like government regulation, how they handle reporters covering them. I feel like if you were to like make a parody of capitalism, Uber would be the company you invent. All right, Gene, let's go from the fight over Uber to housing segregation. You ready?
Okay, yeah, I can do this.
90 seconds on the clock. Go.
So let us stipulate. No, I'm checking. All right, I'm a black dude, right? And I've lived in inner cities. As an adult, I lived in New York and I live in D.C. If you are a black dude in D.C., you cannot get a cab. That's just the reality of it, right? Mm. Like, I just could not get a cab. I could not hail a cab. There's a bunch of reasons for that. They're all really complicated. But the thing is, when Uber came around, it was a godsend, right? It was a really, really, really important introduction into my life, at least. I mean, even though it's messed up and they have all these sort of weird politics, like I could actually get in a car to go places because I was shut out of the taxi cab economy. And I should say, and this is important, the taxi cab economy in DC especially is heavily East African.
Ethiopians mostly.
Exactly. And so, and this is how housing segregation ties into all of this. I think I can do this one. Okay. The fight over taxi cabs in D.C. has also become a racial fight, not just for, like, who gets to be in a cab, but who makes up the taxi cab economy, the traditional taxi cab economy. Mm. Because allowing Uber into D.C. also means that these East African neighborhoods in D.C. get hit really economically hard, right? Because suddenly the people who presumably will be part of their consumer base are taking these other, you know, non-regulated options, the alternatives. Yeah. And so you have these East African neighborhoods that are, like, really, really fighting hard to sort of crack down on Uber. And then East African neighborhoods because there's housing segregation and everything.
In time.
What do you think, Tracy? How about that one?
I do like the dismount at the end.
The dismount was nice. Was I'm not nice gonna dismount. Lie.
Yeah.
We did go from, like, Jean's personal experience with, like, discrimination mm-hmm. with taxis to the actual taxi economy to how East African people in the taxi economy live.
Mm-hmm.
I think that counts.
I think that's another point.
I think that's
Mr.
3 degrees.
I try to contextualize your whole experience. East African cab drivers in D.C.
I see you.
Please
I see you with the history
the
and context.
All right. So we're working on a clean sweep, it looks like.
Okay.
All right.
Oh my gosh. Final topic, Jean. The Pope, the holy man, is coming to Philadelphia.
Mm.
At the end of September. This is Pope Francis's first visit to the United States.
Mm.
And he's going to be there for the World Meeting of Families, which is the largest gathering of Catholic families, some sort of convention situation. And then he's going to be doing, like, a Sunday mass. When I was in Philly for Made in America, there is a giant billboard that made it seem like the Pope co-signs Philly.
What?
Like, Pope approved Philadelphia. It's like, what is this billboard about? But anyways, people are excited the Pope is coming to Philly. Jean, can you take us from the Pope's visit to housing segregation in 6 degrees or less?
All right,
the clock's already. Go.
So this one is, like, right over the plate for me. I'm a Philadelphian. I'm a Catholic. I'm a Black dude. The Pope is coming to Philly, and my mom is going to be there because she's all, oh, the Pope is coming, the Pope is coming. Which is crazy because she's an old Black lady who is excited to see this old white dude who lives across on the other side of the world who makes decisions about her beliefs. Anyway, I will say, so this one is actually, okay. So I want to make some tie here between the cost of Airbnb apartments when the Pope is in Philly, but I don't want to do that. I really want to talk about what it means to be a Philadelphian with certain kinds of facial hair. The Pope.
Ooh. Go on.
The Pope, if, as you've seen, he's, like, clean shaven, whatever, whatever. And Black dudes from Philly, we are not the Pope, obviously.
We have the most glorious beards.
Yes, we have big beards. I just recently trimmed mine, but we have these big beards, and I feel like I'm not going to be able to make this work. I'm not going to be able to make this work.
How are you going from your facial hair to the Pope?
Jeez. I was going to try to make a
20 seconds on the clock.
Oh, man. I can't do this one. This is too.
Not with that attitude, so you can't.
The Pope.
3, 2, 1.
Dang, Tracy, no chill.
Oh my gosh.
This one was hard.
It was tough.
I have no idea how I'd do it. Philadelphian, like, Black people in Philadelphia, like, this really, really big Black Muslim population in Philly that I was going to make a joke about. I was going to make a connection between Blackness and Islam and Philadelphia, and that's all tied into segregation and why Black Catholics, like my mom and my family, are sort of outliers, even because there's blah, 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 but no, I can't do it.
Oh yeah, if only you had made any of these points during the last minute.
Yeah.
All right, you're 2 out of 3, Jean. That's
not
formidable.
Not bad. Round of applause.
For Jean Demby, everyone.
Mr. Jean Demby.
Thank you. Do I get, like, the showcase?
You get nothing.
You get a you try
wow,
button.
Really?
Just kidding. We love you, Jean.
We do. Thank you so much
for having me.
With us.
As usual, follow Jean for all of his housing segregation tweets. He's so fun on Twitter.
I promise.
So fun.
They are more coherent.
Honestly, your Twitter is, like, one of the only places where I see actual conversations happening on Twitter, like thoughtful ones.
And you can occasionally see him screaming at trolls, which
it's
is
beautiful.
Very
it's
fun
just
for me.
So nice. Jean, tell the people what your Twitter is.
My Twitter is GEEDEE215. Philly represent. That's GD215.
And where can people find your work?
I write at Code Switch. That's It's npr.org/codeswitch. Also write at Post Bougie, where we have a podcast. Tracy is my longtime blog mate at Post Bougie.
Hey.
We go back a million years. Squad.
Yo, thanks so much for coming through.
That was 6 Degrees of Housing Segregation with Gene Demby.
Today we are honored and incredibly excited to have Nikole Hannah-Jones on the show.
Yay!
She's an investigative reporter at the New York Times Magazine, but she's written all over the place. And if you're not following her work, like, what are you doing? How are you living your life?
Seriously.
Yes! Welcome, welcome!
Yay! Thank you.
So we like to ask all our guests, what do you do and why?
What do I do? I investigate the way that racial inequality is intentionally created and maintained.
Mm.
And why? I noticed at a very young age that there were very stark differences in the way people lived on my side of town and on the other side of town. And
where did you grow up?
Always Waterloo, Iowa.
Mm-hmm.
Let's just get out of the way. There are black people there. We got lost on the way to Chicago during the Great Migration. Didn't quite make it. I mean, we were from like the country, so when they saw Waterloo, they thought it was the big city, but they weren't quite all the way to the big city.
Mm.
Didn't work out that way. So I'm from Waterloo. And though we have a fairly small black population, it is Iowa after all. There were enough of us that they still managed to segregate us on our own side of town. So I was always a very, you know, bookish, loved history, wanted to understand why things were like they were. And so that's why I started being a journalist. I was actually, I was taking our one semester black studies class in high school with Mr. Ray Dial, who was my only black teacher in high school.
Mm.
And I told him I was complaining about our high school newspaper. I was bused to a white high school. And I told him I didn't like how the paper never wrote about kids like me. And he was like, if you don't like it, write for the paper or I don't want to hear about it anymore. Ooh. So I joined a paper. My first column was from the African perspective.
That was
the name
of my weekly column or monthly. I think it was a monthly paper. My monthly column was from African perspective.
What kind of stuff did you write about in this column?
I did a column on, was Jesus black?
Yes!
I was never able to prove either way, but I made a good case. My first newspaper award was on a column I did on the stereotypes about our side of town and the kids who were being bused into the school.
Mm.
And that's when I really got the bug, because I just realized how much we needed our own voice and we needed to be telling our own stories.
Mm.
So
you talked a little bit about like being really bookish.
Mm-hmm.
What were some of the books or like pop culture things that were transformative for you in your childhood and growing up?
Mm-hmm. I mean, when I was really young, well, I used to get grounded a lot, so I would be grounded to my room with no television, and so I read, like, every book in the house, and my dad loved Louis L'Amour, so I read, like, every Louis L'Amour book, all the Western books, and then my mom was really into Judith Krantz, and so I read her, and her books always had, like, lots of sex scenes, so that was really awesome. To this day, I'm like, Mom, I guess you're just happy I was reading a lot. I would definitely not.
Oh my gosh.
Have my child reading Judith Krantz. I think the first black book I read was like Roll of Thunder, Hear My Cry or something.
Oh, I fell in love with that book.
Classic.
Right, which was like the one black book you would get
in
school.
Right, right.
And it was really like taking this black studies class in high school where this is just like a, you know, the curtain was opened, and I was like, oh, like, we have like a huge freaking history, like a long history, and it sounds silly to say it now, but you only know what you've been exposed to, and I'd never been exposed to anything. And also this book called They Came Before Columbus.
Ooh.
I read that in high school, and it got me in trouble because then I would like come into my history class and challenge my history
with
professor
an attitude,
about things.
Ready to go.
Right, exactly. Yes. Yes. Like, actually, the Olmecs were like, you know, those Olmec heads were from Africa. And he'd be like, Nikole, not today.
Just, oh my gosh.
Sit down. So,
during my like racial awakening when I was the worst, the worst 18-year-old in the world,
right?
My niece, like, I would be like, so we are 11 years apart, right? Me and my niece. And I'd be like, so, you know.
She's younger or older?
She's younger. Uh-huh. Yeah, she's younger. And I'd be like, so, you know, what's your homework like? What'd you learn today? And she'd be like, oh, we learned about how Lincoln freed the slaves. I was like, you go tell your teacher. This is actually how it went down. And my mom was like, you have got to stop. You're going to get this child in trouble. I'm like, she needs to know the truth.
Right.
You need to tell the babies the truth. That was terrible.
But that it's great. Horrible. Like that period of time when you like, I mean, I just remember feeling like so much anger.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Because I'm like, all this time when I thought we weren't shit, we right. actually were shit.
Right. Yes.
But it's like all these years, the only, like all you got was like somebody owned you.
Uh-huh.
And then you had to wait for them to free you.
Right.
And that was it. Mm-hmm. And so like learning like Black history and like reading all those books, like we, me and my friend, like, you know, a lot of Black folks got radicalized mm-hmm. in high school. And I have this, we like led these walkouts and like all this stuff. And I have this picture in a newspaper. I'm wearing like my Malcolm X medallion.
Yes.
Yes.
And it's like, and I'm like, it's not that we're against white people. We're just for Black
we're
people.
For
and I'm
Black
like,
people.
I know my mom, who is white, was like, what the hell?
Oh my God.
What
gosh.
Have I done? Now, to her credit, she let me, you know, work my way through it. She didn't get, internally, she was probably in turmoil, but she let me work my way through it.
Mm. Beautiful. So you have this incredible This American Life episode that you just recently did, where you reported about education and integration, basically. I was bawling by the end. Mm. It is incredibly moving and like a testament to like what real reporting and journalism and storytelling can be.
Mm-hmm.
But I want to set it up a little for the people who are like not living their best lives and haven't heard it yet. Everyone always talks about education reform, but the one thing that seems to never come up in those conversations that has proven to be effective is integration. So at the beginning, you talk about watching Mike Brown's mom during like this very difficult time in her life. But one of the things she was thinking about was like, I got a Black man to graduate high school.
I was watching the coverage of Michael Brown almost a year ago, like the rest of America. There was one moment that I could not get out of my head. It's news footage of his mother, Leslie McSpadden, right after he was killed.
This was wrong, and that was cold-hearted.
She's standing in a crowd of onlookers, a few feet from where her son was shot down, where he would lie face down on the concrete for 4 hours, dead. And this is what she says.
You took my son away from me. You know how hard it was for me to get him to stay in school and graduate. You know how many Black men graduate? Not many.
How did you begin to find like the people to make this story real?
What's important to know is like when Michael Brown's mom says that about, do you know how hard it is to get a Black man to graduate?
Mm.
Her son was literally still lying on the concrete.
Mm.
So the thing that struck me about that was like, you are a mom who has lost your baby. Your baby is lying on the ground behind you dead. And you are talking about school.
Mm. Mm-hmm.
Which in one way is like defies every stereotype we have about Black kids like Michael Brown, like, and their parents, that they don't care about school and the reason they're in shitty schools is just because they don't want better. But I'd also been writing about school segregation for like the past year and a half. So, of course, that just like raised my antenna. So I started just a quick Google search. It didn't take but a couple of minutes to figure out Michael Brown had went to the worst school district in the state, the most segregated school district in the state. So basically, Missouri has a law that says if a district becomes unaccredited, those students have the right to transfer to any nearby accredited district of their choice. And the district can't tell them no. And their home district has to pay for them to go, which is a very radical law.
Yes, that's rare.
That's wild.
Considering what we know about what districts are successful and which districts are failing, it's usually completely racial. This transfer law was letting the students of Normandy, which is where he went to school, go to other districts, which happened to be white. So suddenly you had a quarter of the Normandy school district leaving the district, and that was a big deal. So the state decides, we can't have that. And they try to change the accreditation status of the district and tell those students they had to come back to their failing district. And so the parents sued. And that's kind of where I was able to find the student, Maria, who's in the story, was I contacted the lawyer and I asked for some of the names of the parents who had sued. And then I just talked to a bunch of them. And for many reasons, Nidra and Maria just stood out.
I really enjoyed hearing not just your narration, but like your journalist voice and like in the moment as you're interviewing people.
Yeah, that was dope.
There's this really emotional moment where Maria is kind of breaking down, just recalling one of the meetings where the parents from the other district were like talking about why they don't want kids like her in the school. Mm-hmm. And I obviously was crying. In that moment, do you get emotional? Do you cry?
I don't cry, but of course I get emotional. I'm a human being. And journalists, I actually never have subscribed to this idea that journalists are objective. Of course we're not.
Right. None of us are.
Yeah.
It's a myth that they cling, that, you know, a lot of reporters cling to, but it's obviously not true.
Right.
White journalists experience going through white segregated schools that function well and living in like high functioning white neighborhoods also absolutely impacts the way that they write about these issues.
Absolutely.
Their experiences with police not harassing them, right, absolutely affects whether they believe that police harassment is happening and how they report the issue. So I am actually, and this is what I like about, I think, where journalism is going, is I think people are much more upfront about their biases and their experience. And then it allows the reader or the listener to say, okay, I know this about this person, so now I can examine whether I think this person has actually reported this out and whether it's true or not, as opposed to this false sense of I'm unbiased, this is just the unbiased truth. Well, it's just not true. So I'm obviously reporting this as a Black woman who was bused and who realized that getting out of her segregated schools gave her a lot of opportunity. Mm. With that said, I'm also looking at all the facts, and I'm very, very careful with my facts. So no one can actually dispute what I'm writing, even though they know that about me. Mm. When I was sitting with Maria, my eyes, I definitely got teary-eyed. Mm-hmm. I mean, you're watching this girl and you're seeing her break down because people are basically saying, like, you're trash and you don't deserve to be in the same classroom as my kid. Mm-hmm. And just imagining her sitting there when all that is happening. So I absolutely get emotional, but I think it's that emotion that allows you to really write the compelling narrative and to allow your listeners or your readers to also feel that same emotion.
I thought that the audio footage of that town meeting was like the most striking and infuriating part of the whole story. And I guess some background in case you haven't heard it yet. The parents of Frances Howell got together and they had a town meeting about this band of Black kids that was going to be coming to their school from Normandy. And like, as Heben was saying, like they were just like talking about the reasons that they didn't want it to happen. And just like the vitriol that they were spewing was just like, it was just like, I'm speechless now, and that's how I was when I heard it. How did you get the footage, audio for that?
Yeah, I feel like most reported stories just have that as like a summary.
Yeah.
The fact that there's audio of it.
Yeah, so the local public radio was there. I mean, this was a big deal. This story was huge down there at the time. You have 1,000 kids from, Black kids from a poor district going into a very white district that didn't want them. It was a big story. So the public radio down there recorded the entire meeting. And when I was reporting the written piece, I heard the tape. And that's when I was like, this has got to be a radio piece. Because even if I wrote down everything that they said, there's nothing like hearing it, like hearing the crowd. It sounds like a mob. They're even like, this didn't make it into our the show, but there actually was like a white girl who went to Frances Howell who stood up for the kids coming in, and those parents heckled her down, and she was like one of their own. Hearing that, but also hearing the way that they could talk about race without ever mentioning race, when it was very clear, was very illuminating for people.
We have both, my husband and I both have worked and lived in underprivileged areas in our jobs. This is not a race issue. And I just want to say to, if she's even still here, the first woman who came up here and cried that it was a race issue, I'm sorry, that's her prejudice calling me a racist because my skin is white and I'm concerned about my children's education and safety. This is not a race issue. This is a commitment to education issue.
She reminded me of the Apple Care lady from that vine. I was told by Apple Care. That's what she reminded me of.
today it's like we need the racist of the week, and the only way you're racist is if you say, like, oh my God, I don't like black people.
Yeah. Right.
They didn't have to mention race right. for it to be very clear. When you're like talking about your elementary kids and you're worried about them getting stabbed.
Right. Mm-hmm. Asking for metal detectors.
I have a 5-year-old and I'm like, you're scared of my 5-year-old mm-hmm. daughter.
Exactly. Exactly.
You know, that's crazy.
Oh my gosh.
A lot of what this story brought up for me is remembering and like thinking about how much brown kids have to learn about reading and learning white parents' language.
Ooh.
For example, Maria was talking about how there's this honor roll celebration. She mm-hmm. was on the honor roll. So she knew to bring the letter just in case something yes. bad went mm-hmm. like, why would that happen? Why right. as a kid would you not just be like, yo, right. I'm on the honor roll, let's celebrate.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
But like the little things like that that you have to learn mm-hmm. to like survive in that world.
Yeah.
I think what strikes me about all of these stories is how much of a struggle and how much black kids and also brown kids have to go through to get an equal education. Like, I was bused. It was not easy.
Mm.
And I should not have had to leave my neighborhood and ride the bus for 2 hours a day to get a good education. Mm. And Mario should not have had to do that. But over and over again, the sacrifices are always on the shoulders of black children and their families to try to chase down what is promised to us should yes. be equal. And I think at the end of the piece, when I'm talking to the superintendent, one, it felt very naked for people to hear my interviewing technique.
Oh my God, that was fire.
That was amazing to witness.
Yo,
amazing.
Like that. Bars.
She was like, with all due respect, great, end your whole argument right here in your face.
Right. Bloop, bloop. Can I just say, with all due respect, I've had this conversation with superintendents and principals sure. in districts that look just like Normandy sure. and schools that look just like Normandy for more than a decade. Sure. And you can look at districts and schools with the same racial makeup in every urban community across the country. Right. And the same thing is said. We know what we need to do, mm-hmm. but the schools do not turn around. Typically, an entire district does not turn around.
The entire district has never turned around. It has never happened. But that doesn't relieve us of the charge to attempt to do it. So you're right. It hasn't been done. However, our obligation to attempt to do it, it still remains. The kids are here. So you're right. It hasn't been done. But it's our watch.
So then knowing that in these high poverty segregated districts, the students aren't doing well, mm-hmm. is it possible for a black child in Missouri to get an equal education?
Mm. Wow, what a great question. The answer right now, I really don't know.
And that's what, like, I challenge reporters to do is, like, if we know they're, like, feeding us a line, a bull, just, it's amazing when you call people on it. Mm. They're not used to those kind of questions.
Right. Mm-hmm.
You get really good answers. And his answer was he didn't know, mm-hmm. which was actually him saying, no, black kid cannot get an equal education.
Mm-hmm.
Black kids are the most experimented on kids in the country.
Mm.
They're the ones who are always like, this is the next best thing. We're going to try this. We're going to try that. We're going to try this.
Mm-hmm.
And meanwhile, they're going through school not getting educated. And then we say, you know, when you want to apply to college, it's a merit system.
Mm.
It's not, obviously, a merit system when you've gone to a school where your teachers don't even bother to come into your classroom and you're competing with other kids who are getting the best education. And so I think a lot of my work is driven by knowing all of these kids. Like, I have a 5-year-old, and all of her classmates come to school so happy. She's at a mostly black school to learn. And you just look at them and you wonder, when does that change?
Mm.
When do you stop thinking that school is for you and that people care about your education? And when do you start hating school and getting behind? And that just makes me very depressed.
Ooh.
Like, I literally sat at one of her assemblies and started crying. And I was like, get a hold of yourself. Everyone else is happy, but I'm thinking about, like, I see the future. I know. I've done this long enough to know what happens to these kids. Most of them live in the Farragut houses. So I know what's going to happen to them, and it's not the kids.
Mm-hmm.
It's not the parents. Mm. So
I'm excited for this piece to win all the awards.
Oh,
yes,
Lord.
It better.
As a person who covers a lot of civil rights issues, you obviously have been covering the police brutality epidemic. And you wrote something for Politico called A Letter from Black America, where you were basically like, even amongst like a group of friends who are like well-degreed, high professionals, we sometimes don't even call the police.
We most of the time don't.
Most of the time, yes. So everyone kind of has the talk about police brutality with their children. How do you have that conversation with your daughter?
Lord knows, I don't know. After Sandra Bland, I had this moment because so much. I used to just not want to have a boy, and I thought, you know, having a girl would be hard. She's going to have issues with like how she's perceived, like physically, and her hair and all of this. And I'm like always drilling down about her hair to the point where she's like, "We don't like straight hair, mommy." And I'm like, "No, I'm not. Straight hair is okay, but your hair is curly." And so I wasn't worried about like her safety. Mm. But after Sandra Bland, and of course she was like the umpteenth black person to die in police custody, I just had this moment where I'm like, damn, like I have to prepare her for that too. I have to prepare her for police violence too. Mm. And I was talking to my girlfriend about like when do somebody's going to take that innocence from her. She's 5 now. I don't know when. It has to be me. Mm. I can't let the world take it from her. I have to prepare her. So how much time can I give her before I have to do that? And that's like devastating to me. And I don't know the answer because, of course, like any parent, I want her to hold on to that as long as possible. But I also don't want her to come home because someone else has, you know, exposed her to it and I didn't prepare her. Mm. So I don't know.
I feel like that moment where you realize whether you have a black boy or a black girl, you're still going to have like your hands full and still going to be like a heartbreak trying to raise them in society. It's just like one of the most helpless feelings. Because I always be like, I don't want to have a girl because men are trash. And then all this happened. It's like, well, fuck, I can't have a boy either. Mm. I'm just going to get a puppy.
Okay, Tracy.
A white puppy.
A white puppy. Or a lion. Because at least if something happens and there will be
people will be outraged.
Yeah, white folks will hear about that.
Not a American lion, though.
True. I'd have one imported.
Yeah, that would be a problem.
Oh, my God.
I know.
It's hard. And especially, like, I work at the New York Times Magazine. Mm. You know, it's like all of the things that this country says, if you only do these things, you don't have to worry about that.
Yeah.
And it's just not true.
So I wanted to talk to you a little bit about the upcoming affirmative action case, because you've written about that extensively. I just feel like this case has not gone away. This is the Fisher versus Texas case, where a white woman claimed she was denied admission to the University of Texas because of her race, and it's gone around the Supreme Court, and now it's made it to the top, and it's going to be in our lives again.
Yes.
As a reporter, how do you approach a story like this that has already been so, that already has a lot of big misconceptions built in, which is like nobody really knows what affirmative action is on a basic level.
Right. So the only reason I even wrote about this story was I've always had this nagging question about all of these affirmative action cases, college ones, where I'm always like, how do you know what the other people's test scores and grades were that you're saying got in above you?
Yeah, there's a big presumption.
Right. I never understood how do you know? Like, there's not a list of every single individual's test scores. Mm. So when this case came out and I was reading all of the coverage and I was like, I'm just really curious how she knew that. So I got the court filings and I read it and I was like, it says right in the court filings that there were all these white people who had like worse grades than black people and Latinos who got into the school. And there were like a lot of Latino and black students with better grades than her who didn't get into the school. I did not understand how no one had ever written that, which tells you when I talk about the biases that all reporters have, you have reporters who read that and already have their minds made up about affirmative action. Mm-hmm. Also, their assumptions about who benefits from affirmative action and that black kids are getting in that aren't supposed to. And so they weren't actually reporting the facts that were in the court filings. Mm. And so that story I did was actually one of the like most read stories I've ever done. I think it got like 500,000 hits or something because it was simply saying like, everything that you thought about this case, which is huge, is not wrong. And even the guy who brought the lawsuit said, well, no, we don't actually know that Abigail Fisher was denied because of her race. But just the fact that they even consider race is a problem. But that's not the way the lawsuit is reported. The lawsuit has been reported over and over that she was denied a slot because she was white. I think people should, one, understand there's a reason why all of these plaintiffs are white women and not white men.
Speak on it.
Because no one's going to be sympathetic about a white man saying, I didn't get something. So they intentionally choose white women. who, of course, have been huge benefactors.
Yeah, you know, I think I
have benefited from
the
affirmative
most
action.
Benefited.
Of course.
Right.
I mean, that was actually when affirmative action policies were being passed in the 1960s, the way that they got them to be able to water them down was to include women.
Mm.
So just like all of those things, it's like minorities and women. Which, of course, means white women,
because
any other women would be included as a minority if they're not a white woman. And so you could fill your affirmative action, quote-unquote, quotas by hiring a white woman. And no one ever talks about that.
Mm.
And so, you know, it's different when it's black folks, because you can't relate to that and you think we're always trying to get something that we don't deserve.
Mm. Yeah, we're not the same kind of human that they are, so it's like, what?
But it also goes back to the This American Life piece, and this is why I talk about the idea. I mean, what affirmative action is saying is we do not have an equal system.
Right.
And a black kid is not coming out with the same opportunity. So how can that kid score the same on an SAT when they never even had physics offered at their high school? When they never even had a certified teacher teaching them English.
Right.
So what affirmative action tries to do is mitigate all of our inequality in the K-12 system and to eliminate that. Well, this is my other thing. Like, most universities are like 4 to 8% black.
Right.
So who's, I'm like, all the other, you want all the seats.
Right.
You know? I mean, it's one thing. It's like suddenly these schools were like 50% black and we're only 12% of the population, then you could be like, okay, something's like off here.
Mm-hmm.
But like that you're mad about like the 4% of seats that black folks are getting, I don't really understand.
We literally cannot have anything.
Yeah, I don't understand that.
Affirmative action also confuses me because the way we talk about it, or I'm not even sure I understand the legal precedent, but the way we talk about it is often that it is a benefit for white students and like the larger university community. I don't understand that part of it.
The best argument for affirmative action is inequality.
Right.
But the Supreme Court has basically like said all of those arguments no longer stand. It has winnowed out all of those arguments.
Mm-hmm.
So the only argument that can be made is that one. Like
right.
that diversity is important, which is the weakest argument.
Yeah.
But that's the only one for whatever reason that the Supreme Court allows. So when they're arguing, when the lawyers are arguing before the court, they can't even bring up any of the best arguments, which is the problem. Here's my thing too with affirmative action. Because of course, all of us who like have made it somewhere have like a whole line of people thinking that we only got here because we're black.
Yeah.
And this is where it's the catch-22. Because if you don't do anything with your life, it's like, you're black, you don't want anything, you have no culture of work.
You're feeding a stereotype.
But if you do make it, it's like, oh, you didn't deserve it.
Yeah.
Somebody gave it to you. So there's really not a way that you can win here.
It's a lose-lose situation.
Except, you know, if I'm here, I'm still winning.
Mm.
As opposed to the people who haven't been able to make it out. But yeah.
Another award you won recently, where I saw you last, is the NABJ Journalist of the Year. That's the National Association of Black Journalists. Well-deserved. But in the speech, you talked basically about how everyone's tired of the, we can't find enough qualified people. There's literally a convention center full of us.
Right. Literally.
And I just heard so many ums in the audience.
Like a church service.
Did you ever feel like it's just not working? Or hit a road where, like, you just couldn't do it anymore?
Yeah. I mean, in my speech, when I accepted the award, I talked about 4 years ago, I literally was, like, looking at communications jobs.
Mm.
I was at a paper where I was, like, getting called into the room for meetings about writing about black people and wanting to write about black people too much. Even though I actually counted all of my stories, and they were, like, 10% of my stories even happen to have somebody in there who was black. I remember when I first started out and I was like gung-ho about race and diversity, and I would try to like get the more veteran black reporters and they'd be like, yeah, good luck with that. And I'd be like, y'all are some sellouts. But then I realized, no, it's like they came in the same way too when you get beaten down.
Yeah.
And you either are like, I just have to put my head down and do my work, or I have to like leave
and go
the
PR
profession.
Or something.
Right. So I was totally at that point 4 years ago, and I was like in Portland, Oregon. I felt like I had like so much still to give, but I was like, is this where I end? Like, is this it? Is this what I worked my whole life for, is like be in Portland and then go into PR? So I think it's very common. I think that newsrooms like to think of themselves as being extremely progressive, and, you know, they get it and they care. But as we know, the passive aggressiveness of progressive people
will
kill you.
Oh my, gosh,
yes.
So why did you stay?
You know, I got a call from Steve Engelberg at ProPublica. Mm-hmm. I was literally like looking for jobs. I always wanted to be a journalist. Like, mm-hmm. I could not imagine not being a journalist. So it was very hard. All of my friends had left the newsroom by that point. There were like just a couple of us left. And then Steve called me and like saved my life. Like, he told me to come do for him what I always wanted to do. Mm-hmm. So,
Steve. Is that what brought you to New York?
That's what brought me to New York. Mm. And now, 4 years later, I'm talking to y'all.
Yes. my personal favorite part of your speech was when you talked about your feminist husband who moved around with you all the time.
Yes, ma'am.
Please tell us more about your feminist husband.
Tell me more.
We love him.
So my husband comes from like a totally traditional military, like very religious family. Mm. And very early on in our relationship, his dad was like, you need to be a man. Like, you can't keep following this woman around. But my husband was like, no, he's completely supportive. I cook and I let him take out the garbage because that's what we want to do. But yeah, he's moved like over and over to support my career, and it's been pretty amazing. So,
wow. Like, how many places have y'all lived in?
We moved from Georgia to North Carolina, from North Carolina to Portland, from Portland to New York.
Whew.
Oh, so, my God. That's so a beautiful.
Lot. That is a lot. Aw, shout out to the feminist husband.
I know. Hey, there are some good men out there.
Where they at, though?
Right? I know.
All right, we're going to move into our rapid fire questions segment. Lord. We call pew, 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 pew.
You know how I get it.
It's my fault that it's called pew, pew, pew.
Let me take a drink.
Yes, yes. Right. Throw it back. Okay. We are, by this point, legally obligated to ask you this first question because Twitter gets so mad when we don't ask it of our guests. Mm. So question number one, how do you feel about squirrels?
Squirrels are rats with furry tails.
Excellent.
Standing ovation. My spirit is standing up. I'm not standing up. What's your favorite board game?
Taboo.
Oh, God. I mean,
let her live, Tracy.
No, it's fine. Taboo I get why people like Taboo. It just aggravates my anxiety so much. You got somebody in your ear with a little buzzer.
I know, that's my favorite part. Like,
Oh, my gosh. My brain always goes blank, and I'm just like,
Okay, I'll just remember not to have you on my team.
Don't. If you care about winning, do
everything
not have
I do, I do with a killer instinct. So you do not want to be on my team if you're not like,
don't cross
on it.
Let's just not play. We ain't got to worry about teams. At what age did you become an adult?
Oh shit. Well, according to R. Kelly.
Oh God.
16.
Oh my gosh, my drink is so empty. Shit. Okay.
The aura.
What is your least favorite thing about new media?
Too little reporting.
Ooh. Do you want to say more?
I just think there's like a lot of people who just write essays and what they think and don't do much reporting. But somebody has to do the reporting, or what the hell are you writing about? So
listen.
Bloop, bloop. That's bloop, bloop, bloop.
But I'm old school. I came up through newspapers. I'm old school.
Is there anything you miss from newspapers that you wish was like a part of new media culture?
That's a good question.
That is a good question. I think just local beat reporting.
Mm.
Like, that's how you learn to be a good reporter, is you're assigned to the boring-ass county government.
Yeah.
And you get to know everybody on the beat, and you have to go to the Thursday night meetings, and you have to type out a story that night. I think that that's, like, the best training. And I think a lot of younger journalists, I know I sound old, but a lot of younger journalists who just come up through media are missing a lot of the basics of reporting. They don't know how to source. They can't turn around a good reported story in a short period of time. So I think I missed that. And, you know, everybody didn't have a graduate degree and everyone didn't come with this pedigree. Like, you know, you had just more like real folks, and you don't see as much of that now.
That is a very good point. What is your favorite 90s R&B jam?
I mean, my favorite song, period, which is from the 90s, because I am a child of the 90s, is Method Man and Mary, All I Need.
Can we quickly talk about how fine Method Man still is? He just refuses to, like, age. He refuses to.
And I don't even like light-skinned men, but...
That one gets a pass, right? That one
but
gets
for
a
him,
pass.
Even, I mean, you know, on the video, he had a, like, weird eye contact thing. But even so, yeah, that is, like, my all-time favorite song, period.
Yeah, so. That's a great. That's
plus,
a great
anything story. Mary back then.
True.
Yes. My Life, come on.
My Life is one of my favorite albums.
I mean, yeah.
All time.
Seriously, my daughter sings that because I still play that joint.
Ah, parenting so. Done right. Parenting goals. So if you could make a biopic of any musician's life,
Tupac.
Who would you pick? Pac, okay. Has there been a good Pac documentary?
There hasn't been. There's been documentaries, but biopic, not a biopic at all.
Yeah.
But yeah, I think it's hard to cast. Uh-huh. Like, I can't even imagine.
Yeah. The guy that they got to play Pac in Straight Outta Compton at least looks like him a lot. I don't know too much about his... Yeah, I don't know too much about his acting skills because he didn't have that much screen time. But like... Yeah, he kind of looked like him. Like, he had, like, the
because Pac and Notorious was not
no.
New.
Oh, yeah.
No, that was a capital no.
That was bad. Well, I overall like the movie. But
yeah. Yeah.
So, yeah. He's like he's my all-time favorite. I was in the Tupac fan club.
Aww.
I was crying when he got killed.
Aww. Everybody was crying when he got killed. So sad. I remember I was at a high school football game.
I was driving to Flint, Michigan with my girlfriend.
Mm. And you heard?
And I heard on the radio. I know I want to pour out some of this liquor right now, but it's carpet, so we probably shouldn't do that.
One more? I think we only have one more. What is your favorite board game? No, we did that. Shout out to Bourbon. I think
Spades. Does that count?
I still don't
even
know.
For black people, it counts. I don't either. Oh, Heaven, I'm glad you said that.
Oh, shit. We just had a conversation about this yesterday.
Oh, yes.
Did you speak up?
No, I did not. You can't say you don't know how to play spades around black people.
No.
You can't.
You can't say it out loud.
No, among bougie black folks, apparently, is very common.
It's true, but like I had no one to teach me it. Like, my parents are Ethiopian. They don't know about spades.
Okay.
That shit is intimidating. Right. Like, the first thing I heard about spades is that there's always a fight. So I'm
you don't know how to play spades either? From Kentucky?
Okay, well, here's the thing. My uncle taught me.
I don't even know what to say right now.
You know what? We're going to wrap this
up. Yeah, we need to wrap it up right now.
I honestly don't even know what it looks like.
I at least know what it looks like. I know the language.
I shouldn't have said that out loud.
You shouldn't. Okay, can I redeem myself and say that I know that there are books and you can renege? And...
Well, you shouldn't renege.
Oh, but it's an option?
You don't want to be a renigger.
Oh, well, on that note.
I do know. I know the game for that verb, honestly.
Right?
I'm just like, wait, what are you guys saying?
I know you're like, hold on, wait. Who made up that term?
Well, you should teach us to play spades one day.
Absolutely. I have actually been asked to host a spades party.
Ooh.
Ooh.
Is this our official?
Bring your strap. It's very serious.
Well, I'm excited. This has been...
Such a blessing.
Such a blessing.
Well, thank you. You're
I feel like
blessing.
You're at such an incredible point in your career.
Don't
so
say
for
that.
You to even like...
I feel like that set me up for the fall.
No. For like the like extended rise.
Okay,
for
good.
You to even let bless us with your presence.
Right.
At
right.
the
right.
arc
moment.
Of my career still be bending towards highness.
Yes.
Yes. Yes. Exactly.
Martin Luther King Jr.
Exactly.
And
we're
you came
almost
by,
talking about the same thing.
You came by even though you're on deadline for the most or the next amazing thing that I'm sure you're gonna do. So
and sick. So yes.
And sick. Listen.
Blessings on blessings.
Blessed. Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Is there anything that you would like to promote? Where can people find you? What's going on?
I'm on Twitter, Ida Bay Wells. Just kidding. N Hannah Jones, and I have a website. So.
Okay, is the website.
They can find me on the Google.
On the Google.
NikoleHannahJones.com.
She writes regularly at New York Times.
Look out for my new
magazine.
Single. Just kidding.
Oh, mixtape coming soon.
My new single is dropping.
It's lit. It's lit.
It's my diss tape of Meek.
Oh my God, that'd be incredible.
Please
nah,
do
it wouldn't.
This.
It
did you ever think you were going to be a rapper?
No.
Oh.
I did for a long time.
Well, I definitely wanted the salt and pepper hair back in the
Ooh,
day.
Oh, yes.
No.
That asymmetric cut was everything.
Mm-hmm.
Well,
did you hear all that happened?
Huh?
Did you hear all that happened?
No.
Her hair got like burned out on one side.
And she just made it that work.
Is how she made music hair history.
Yes.
She changed the entire game.
Ingenuity, man.
Damn. That's incredible. Follow Nikole for her mixtape and more and more hip hop observations.
That's right.
Thank you so much for stopping by.
Thank you.
It was a pleasure. Heben McGee.
Oh my God. Why is that so funny? Tracy McGee, how you doing?
I'm great. I'm ready to buy some rounds. You want to go first? Who you been around for?
Remember when you said you didn't know who Tony Hawk was? Yes. That was so insulting to my spirit.
I got a very angry tweet.
Like, good. I'm glad. Anyways, I would like to buy a round for the Tony Hawk video game soundtracks.
Oh, the soundtrack.
Yes. Mm. So when we were kids, we like begged and begged and begged and begged for a PlayStation. And we like didn't really have a lot of toys growing up. We like made board games and shit like out of paper. So we were like, yo, just give us this one thing. So like my parents finally caved. And you know how like all game consoles are like $200, mm-hmm. which is exorbitant. Yeah. So they got it for us, but they they didn't realize the games were also really expensive. So they never bought us games. Because the games would be like the good ones are like $50.
Yeah.
It's like it's the fourth of the console. Anyways, so like at that time they all came with like a sample pack. And in our sample pack was like Madden, I don't know, Spyro, that dragon dude.
Oh, I always wanted to play that game.
Crash Bandicoot and Tony Hawk video game. Mm-hmm. So obviously we played all of those, the sample games of like the first level of each one.
Right.
I feel like the Tony Hawk video game soundtrack is what introduced me to like my emo pop punk phase.
That's so real. I had a similar experience after I started playing Guitar Hero. A lot of good screaming emo-like songs.
Yes.
30 Seconds to Mars, what's up?
So I would like to play one for you.
Yay.
It's called Superman by Goldfinger. Of course. Here's a little taste of young emo heaven.
Oh. So here I am, doing everything I can.
Very angsty, even though it sounds happy. That is an accurate description of me.
It is.
Me right now, IRL.
The soundtrack of Heben's life.
Yes. Also, in like a different lifetime, I think I would have been like a pro skateboarder.
Maybe it's not too late.
Last year, Kanye West was like the headliner at the X Games. That's like the Oscars for skateboarders. And I felt like all of my lives were combining just in this one moment for me. I was like, thank you, universe. So there's this picture of Tony Hawk and Kanye West sitting next to each other. I was like, thank you. Aww. This is specifically for me. So yeah, shout out to Tony Hawk. Shout out to all the skateboarding video games. But
skateboard. Skateboard. Yes.
But also shout out to the Tony Hawk soundtrack. Who are you buying around for?
I'm buying around for hookah in hookah lounges.
Okay, I'm listening.
I was always like, this is the dumbest thing that I've ever, like, nothing happens. It doesn't taste like vanilla citrus mint at
all.
Yeah,
the flavors be mass specific.
Right, exactly. I'm just like, this is so stupid. But when was it? Last weekend, I think? I find myself at this I finally went to Queens. I went to go play around in Queens.
Yes, that's the best place for hookah. Hookah and food.
Yes. And it was like a Saturday and it was really nice outside. It was breezy. And I remember my pants were way too tight. I'm outgrowing all of my clothes, right? But I have this really cute pair of jeans. I was like, no, I'm getting these jeans. I'm going out. And like, it wasn't really a lounge. Like, all the chairs are just like regular bar chairs or whatever. So I'm sitting in this chair and I'm not very comfortable. I'm like, all right, whatever. I'll do like a couple puffs and then be like, all right, it's time to go. And so I did it and I like took it into my lungs. And I also had some random happy hour drink. And within like 3 minutes, it felt like my brain was like floating to the top of my skull, but in a good way. It was Jesus. Great. It was great. It felt like there were a bunch of like tiny little effervescent bubbles like popping in my brain at the same time. And I was like, oh my God, this feels so, like it was just really relaxing. I was just like super, super chill. And I was like, why don't I do this every day of my life? Like, I got so comfortable. I took off my shoes. This is outside. I'm like, where was in the outside seating.
I was like, you're in a restaurant.
No, it was outside. I unbuttoned my tight ass pants and I laid back and I just smoked hookah. I figured I had to blow smoke out of my nose. I was like, I'm a fucking boss. I've never felt that cool in my life. There's a great picture of me doing hookah at another place, blowing smoke out of my nose. It's going to be my Neo Soul album cover.
Ooh.
It's so good. I'm thinking of going to do some hookah after I leave here because I'm just like super stressed.
Unwind a little.
Yeah, like a glass of Prosecco and like some some guava hookah. I don't know. Yeah.
Do they got mango though?
Most places I've been have mango.
Okay.
All three places. Yeah, so we should do some hookah sometime. But like the buzz that it gives me is just like just enough, you know? And if I like hit my plateau and I need to like get a little wavier, as the kids say, just get another glass of Prosecco, you know, and you can just like wavy, keep it wavy. But I love it. It makes me feel super cool. It bothers me that I'm probably polluting my lungs, though. But it's so expensive up here that I can't do it often enough. Shout out to hookah.
I feel like you're living your best life right now, Tracy.
I am. Baby, pass me the hookah.
I do not know what you're doing. What is that song?
What? Tyga and Young Thug. It's the song that Tracee Ellis Ross was singing in all of her Instagram.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
We did it. We did it. We did it. Hooray.
You started the song while I had a mouthful of bourbon.
I'm sorry.
It's okay. It's okay.
Special shout out to Nikole Hannah-Jones for stopping by. Like, I just feel so much smarter just sitting next to her. Please don't forget the little people when you win a Pulitzer. Come back. We love you.
Take us with you.
Yes. Shout out to the Pod Squad.
Pod Squad.
We have some new credits for you guys because we just want to make sure you understand everything that everyone does on the squad.
Yes, these are real people with real jobs.
Yes. So this podcast is produced by Eleanor Kagan. You know her. You love her.
Yay.
Editorial oversight by Jenna Weiss-Berman. You know her. You love her. Production support comes from Julia Furlon. And the newest member of our Pod Squad is Meg Kramer. What up, Meg?
Yay.
Say hi to Meg, guys.
Hi, Meg.
Thanks for demonstrating, Tracy. And as always, shout out to Paul Rest of Argo Studios.
Today's dance is jazz hands.
Yes.
Yay.
Paul's got the ill jazz hands.
Also, a thank you to our in-house musicians. That is Jean Gray. You can find her online on Twitter at Jean Greasy. And Don Will of the Almighty Tanya Morgan. You can follow him on Twitter at D-O-N-W-I-L-L. Thank you to the Heaven.
Thank you to the Tracy.
Heaven, where can people find you?
I don't have a thing yet for
a different
one.
This is my favorite part of every show.
Why is it such a struggle? Anyways, Heaven, the noun, Rance, the verb.
My favorite.
Can someone help me come up with a better one?
If you have a better explanation of Heaven's Twitter name that she can say while
with relative ease.
With relative ease.
It's not, I don't need like a paragraph after every one. I'm doing too much. Where can the people find you, Tracy?
The people can find me on Twitter at Brokey McPoverty. That is Brokey as in I'm broke. That is McPoverty as in I am broke. And follow us on Twitter and email us stuff and follow us on Facebook at Another Round. Take your freaking medicine, everybody.
Also, go on vacation.
Ooh.
If you can.
If you can. I can.
Or staycation.
Staycation.
Staycation's real.
Yeah. Try to drink like 2 glasses of water today.
Back up your data.
Back up. I still have not done any of that. Eat some grapes.
Oh, yeah. I'm into that.
Mm-hmm. Do that. Eat some grapes. All right, guys. That's all I got.
Until next time.
Bye.
Bye.
Nice. Heaven, do you love pigeons now? Do you hate them less?
I do hate them less.
Yay!
I'm not saying my dislike wasn't necessary or fueled by real things.
That is fair.
I hate them slightly less.
Yay.
That's all you can ask of me.
Then I have done my job.
Wait. On the soul matrix, where did they land?
Oh, they definitely have souls.
Okay.
Absolutely. Update your spreadsheets, kids. Pigeons have souls.
No one else has a spreadsheet.